All right, now we're rolling.
Do you want me out of the focus?
Oh, no, I don't. It doesn't bother me at all.
I'm just kidding. Would you like your camera?
I would like it too if you can go to my Facebook.
Oh, come on.
I have my pictures on. That's why I did the last class. It's easy presentation. It's not a photo album. And I can touch
it. Yes, did you see me? Right there?
You seem like you're pretty in.
As long as we can get
it's
to
coming.
Oh, it is okay. Oh, no, that's okay. What's your name?
Kimberly.
Oh,
you can probably see
Marissa.
Yes.
And you take what?
But who's the
third, fourth, and fifth grade.
Great. Carrie, away from
the apartment. Thank you for coming today.
You're welcome.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
I have a nice thank you. Okay, let me get this going real quick.
Oh, my God.
Just take a second. Every bug has a bug that hunts it. Most, and so in your yard you develop an ecosystem. And the ecosystem is bugs hunting other bugs. And like for instance, there's, you guys know what symbiosis means? Okay, symbiosis means one animal working with another animal to the mutual benefit of the, of each animal. For instance, there's a little bugs on the bottoms of leaves called aphids. Aphids live under leaves and they hook onto the plant and they suck the juice out of the plant, basically. And it hurts it, it doesn't like it. So aphids are bad for plants, we don't, but aphids themselves are not bad. They hook onto the underneath of the leaf, and then as they eat, they digest the food, and then they poop out a little green ball. And it's not gross, it's just a little green ball of sugar water, kind of. Ants have figured out how to harvest those little green balls and take it back to the ant nest to feed their babies. So ants became aphid farmers. And there you see this all over the place. It's funny to watch because the ants are going up and down the tree or the little plant and they're taking care of all their little aphid farms. Along comes a ladybug. Ladybugs are cute, right?
Yeah.
Real cute. Do you all know ladybugs are monsters?
No.
They're monsters to aphids. Little aphids are tiny compared are this big compared to this. This thing is like, can you imagine having a thing the size of Publix coming up to you? Whoop, and it takes you out. So one ladybug eats 4,000 aphids in its life cycle. That's a lot of aphids, you can imagine. So aphids see a ladybug coming and they're not happy. But they are very cute. But they're what's called a beneficial garden insect for gardening. Because you release ladybugs into your garden and they crawl underneath everything and get the aphids. These are seed baskets. Later on, when we get done with the talk, I'll pass the seed baskets around. You guys can get some seeds, okay? And I'll show you where they come from. Every plant that grows goes through its cycles of growing it, what is either a fruit or leaves that animals eat, or that humans eat. And then when they're done, they go to seed. Because going to seed is how they stay alive. It's like us having children. They basically make little babies, and then they drop the babies on the ground, and then new plants come up from the seed. So these are Native American seed baskets from Arizona, and those are seeds, probably they look like broccoli seeds. So a giant broccoli plant comes out of this little tiny seed, about a millimeter wide. This is a picture from my garden. These are cabbages. This is called Mizuna. Mizuna is a Japanese type of green that's very delicious. And what you see here is a type of companion planting where you companion planting is where you put one plant with a different kind of plant because those plants help each other. One makes certain bugs go away, and the other one makes other types of bugs go away. So the plants are happy because they help each other. That's why you don't plant everything all in one block. You want different kinds of plants. You want diversity in the plants, just like we have diversity in nature and diversity with human beings. Have you guys ever seen a close-up of a leaf? That's a certain type of leaf, but most of them have these pathways. The little aphids hook on to these little pathways, because those are the veins of the leaf. Now, isn't it funny that these right here are the veins that are inside of each and every one of you guys? And this right here that looks also like veins, that's a picture from above looking at the world's largest river, which is the Amazon River. So you can see how nature has patterns in it that follow through everything, through plants, through humans, and through the planet itself. So these same patterns show up all over the place. Even if you looked at the universe, everything that we can see as far as the universe is concerned looks like a neural network in your brain. This is one of the most important things I try to get across, is to do what you love in life. When you pick out something you want to do later, make sure that you really love doing it, like you have fun doing it. When I say you love it, it means you have fun, you can't wait to do it. That way work is easy. Okay, some different types of vegetables you can grow and combinations that are good for you, like beets. A lot of kids don't like to eat beets. Avocados, tomatoes, these are nuts, broccoli.
Thank you for listening.
I know, I hated onions when I was a kid. They were just the most disgusting thing to me. I could not stand the smell of onions or get them away from me. Now I eat them raw. I love onions, any kind of onion. Doesn't matter what kind it is, I'll eat it all. you guys start trying different vegetables, like right now, just be experimental. It's like, I dare you to try it. How about that? And that way, you start getting your tongue to make connections with your brain, like, okay, that's not as bad. Everyone said it was gross. But you know when vegetables are put in a can and you eat it out of the can, it is gross. I agree with you. Canned peas can be bad. That's why it's better to grow them in your backyard. It's so easy to grow them. One little tiny seed makes that huge broccoli. All you have to do is put it in the ground, give it some food, and have living soil underneath it. These are some things that have iron in them. Spirulina, probably never, a lot of people, especially kids, haven't heard these. You guys, chia seeds. They have a thing called the chia pet that you can grow that green hair on top of the head. Cool. I don't know if they have those anymore, but the chia seeds that they use that are very healthy to eat. Same with kale, and then we have mushrooms here. Oh. Eating mushrooms is very important.
I'll eat mushrooms.
I know, but the whole world of mushrooms, if you can ever learn. Remember, I hated onions, and now I'm eating onions. So just put it in your brain to someday try them. They can be good. It depends on how you cook them. Not canned mushrooms. These are different kinds of lettuces here, and things you can put in salads.
Thank you for listening.
Most people think salads are like iceberg lettuce, tomato, and cucumbers. Most kids, when you think of salad, salad is almost any green leafy vegetable you can put in a salad. There are some weird ones, like this is radicchio. This is dandelion. Now this is a weed that'll grow in your yard with a yellow flower at the top. And this is what people are putting Roundup and poisoning it. But it's a salad green. They're poisoning food and they don't even know it because they don't want to bend over and pick it up. This is escarole, endive. This is called mache. There's oak leaf lettuce. There's Lola Rasa lettuce. This is like a bib lettuce here. So all these can be made into salads. These are some different vegetables you can grow in the yard. Root vegetables. This is kale. We got a pomegranates, and we have some other root vegetables. Let's see, is it hard to read that? And these are all carrots. Carrots aren't only orange. They come in purple. They come in all different kinds of colors. And they come in long ones, little short ones. Okay, these are all for you guys. Know what these are, right? These are all fruits that you love. And some weird ones, like a dragon fruit. You can grow dragon fruits. Okay, now. Remember I was talking about poisons a little while ago? Mm-hmm. How companies are making lots of money to poison the world and kill all the insects. And they really are. They have mosquito companies here that set up timers that spray poison on a regular basis at people's houses. And not only kills the mosquitoes, it kills the butterflies, it kills the bees, it kills flying pollinators. And it's a terrible thing that's happening right now. Scientists just came out saying we've lost 80% of the bees. I mean, excuse me, insects worldwide. And that is an alarming thing to me. It's very scary because see all these fruits you all love? Just never eat them again. Goodbye, they're going to be gone. How would you feel if you could never eat a cherry or an apple? Now think about that. Think about none of those foods being available. If there's no more bees, about 80% of the food that we like to eat in the grocery store, in the produce section, will not be there. You know why bees are so important? Because bees fly from flower to flower. And they get the nectar out of there to make honey. So each flower has something the bee wants. And the reason why it goes in there is to get the honey. So it attracts it to get the nectar to make the honey. But while it's there, the bee has little hairs on its legs, and it picks up the pollen inside the flower, and it flies to another flower. And when it drops that pollen from its legs, that's what makes the fruit come and become a piece of fruit. So if you don't have that bee doing that, you're not going to get the fruit. Certain ones will pollinate without bees. They're self-pollinating fruits, but the majority of what we love is in danger of not being able to be grown. It's so bad that companies are making robotic insects to pollinate them because it's very difficult to get everyone to stop using poison. That's why my main mission is to heal the land. You have a question?
Why do bees sting?
Bees only sting if you are coming near their nest or hurting them. They'll never come and find you to sting you. If bees are flying around, I had a bee nest inside my yard, honeybees, and they would fly around me, thousands of them. and never sting me, not one time. You know why? Because I wasn't afraid of them. We have things, chemicals that come out of us. When you're afraid of something, you smell a certain way to dogs, to animals, and to bees. They're called pheromones, and pheromones make you smell a certain way. When you're afraid, you smell afraid. So if you smell afraid, a bee thinks that maybe you're going to hurt its nest or hurt it. But bees are really, I've had them land on my hand, you know, I picked them up off the ground when they were tired, and you give them a little sugar water from my finger, and it flies away. It never stung me. Now, there are insects that can hurt you, but bees and wasps, you know, some people, kids are very allergic to them, and it can be very dangerous for them to be around bees. So it's not for everyone. So, but in general, bees aren't there to hurt you. They're making all the fruit of the world go round. What's up, buddy? Oh, bathroom? Okay. All right, so compost is all the stuff that's left over from the garden, all the eggshells, all the coffee grounds, all the things that come out of the kitchen that are organic scraps, but no meat, no dairy, no cheese and stuff like that goes in there. But everything goes in there, vegetable scraps, fruit peels, algae, coffee grounds, tea grounds, house plants, spent like flowers that are done, poop from herbivore animals. Herbivore, what is that? That means animals, I know this. Animals that eat vegetables, like and grasses, like horses, llamas, rabbits,
cows.
Chickens, cows, exactly. Alfalfa is a different type of plant. Weeds that haven't gone to seed. Now we're talking about plants going to seed. You can put weeds in the compost. Compost, what it does, all these things break down, and you mix them with this all wet green stuff. You mix it with the dry brown stuff. And that actually breaks down and turns into the best soil to put into your garden because it has microbes in there. Microbes are the tiny living creatures that live in the soil that make vegetables grow incredibly well. If it wasn't for the microbes, there would be really no gardens. And the microbes are also being hurt by the poisons that they're putting in the ground. That's just a nice picture of an ant. This is an ant. Looks like it's standing on its hand, and it probably is. But the even the little ants are important, and they have a role to play, just like every single other insect. And this says, beneath the surface, beauty lies. That means all the microbes that are in the ground that help things grow. You all know that in a forest full of trees, that the trees communicate with each other. They talk to each other. Scientists just found this out, that mushrooms, you know the mushrooms you guys see in the store? The mushroom is actually a flower of the real mushroom. The real mushroom you never see. The real mushroom lives under the ground, and it sends up these little tendrils, and then that mushroom comes out at the top. And that's how it reproduces. It drops spores from those flowers, and more mushrooms will grow. But the real mushroom is deep underground. So the tree's roots go down to the ground, and it has all the mushrooms growing through it. And the trees talk to each other from far away through the fungus network of the mushrooms. They've just found this out. They found that trees, if you cut a tree down in the middle of a bunch of other trees, all the trees around it will send nutrients and water to that stump to get it to regenerate until the thing rots away. And they're like relentless in trying to save their tree friends. And this is recent stuff. This is Miss Breck, who's the art teacher over at the STEAM program at Canterbury. This is the garden that they were yesterday helping me transplant some stuff. All these gardens, because my company, that's what I do, is I teach people in schools how to grow organic food forests and raised bed gardens. So right here you see these are made of logs. All these logs came from Hurricane Irma trees that were knocked down. And I go to the brush site and I bring them back in my truck. This garden probably took about 10,000 pounds of logs. 10,000 pounds is like maybe 3 or 4 cars in weight of logs. So I move all those in there, and then I pin them together, and then plant them. There's some students transplanting some marigolds. You have to have the flowers in your vegetable garden. You have to have a lot of flowers. They're called pollinator flowers. And the flowers are what bring the bees to your yard, especially milkweed. That'll bring really beautiful butterflies. And here we are planting again. There's a bee. See, that's a close-up of a bee. See the little hairs right here, and the hairs right here, that's got some pollen on it right there. And down here in the flower is where it wants to get the nectar. But all these little white dots that you see along here are it picking up the pollen that's going to go to another flower. Where you see these little petals here, that's the middle part of the flower where the bee picks up the pollen. And this is again about saving seeds. There's some companies, really bad companies out there, that make seeds for plants. So when you grow the plant, it won't make seeds. They took away its seed making ability. They genetically modified it. Not all genetically modified foods are bad, but when the company takes away seeds because they want you to buy seeds from them every year, that's bad. Because seeds are, you know, God made seeds to come back and back and back over and over again. All right, and there's a ladybug again. I'm going to say goodbye with ladybug. And I've got a few minutes for questions, but let me log out of this real quick.
Bye,
ladybugs, and you can release, you can buy ladybugs and release them into your yard. Okay, I got some seeds over here I want to show you guys. Okay, I'm just going to walk down and you guys can each pick a seed out.
All of us?
Yep.
No, Steph,
no you guys can all stay where you're at. I'll come to you, okay?
She's visually disabled, so you might have to assist her.
Okay, these are beans. Feel them.
I'm feeling.
Yeah, how does it feel?
Nice, because are they white?
They're white, and some are brown, and some are black. Neat, aren't they?
Yes.
Do you want some of them?
Yeah, a lot of them.
Okay, well, I have to save some for the other kids, but let me pick some out for you, okay? And you can hold it.
A lot of
you
them.
You can't eat these, okay? You can plant these at home with your parents.
Well, I'm going to...
Just put them in soil, and then keep the soil really damp, okay?
Yeah, because that's what I do every other day at home.
Okay, good. Now, you hold on to them. You put them right here on the table.
Oh, my God.
All right. These are beans, you guys, of different kinds, white northern beans, lima beans. Just grab a couple, get a couple of them out of there.
Don't eat it, Steph.
And no, these are not beans you eat. Yeah, I mean, you can eat these, but they're like dried beans you have to boil. So, but these will make plants. Every one of these will make a plant. And all you guys do is get some good organic potting soil in a little pot, put it about an inch down, cover it up, and water it. You got, you probably know, that's too many. I got other classes. No, you're good, though. Each one of those will make a plant that will make this many beans. You go, dear. You can have more.
Last year I tried to plant an apple seed, but I forgot to plant.
Now I grew these myself in my backyard. These are this season's bean crop.
So if
I wasn't going to grow more beans out of these, I would soak them overnight for 24 hours, and then I would cook them. If you want to soak them to eat them, you have to soak them about 24 hours in some good water. Remember, you can put them in soil and they'll grow a plant. And then you can put that plant somewhere and they'll grow and climb up something. All right.
Where is your Urban Micro Farms?
Urban Micro Farms is
I'm
off of like 4th Street and 45th Avenue, roughly by the Unity Church there. But Urban Micro Farms are all the places that I make farms at. Family homes that have little farms. So it's a network of farms.
Okay.
There are other people, including mine. You know, mine's at home.
And is it a lucrative business for you?
Well, it's getting there. I've been doing this about 10 years, and I did it outside of my other business. I basically did it just on the side, and I'm still doing it on the side. But as I get more schools involved, then it becomes more full-time. And it's not like a business I would say that I would have stock in. You know what I mean? It's not, I'm not going to go public with it or anything. It's just something I can make a living with myself. Yeah, I don't want to get super wealthy, just want to pay my bills.
Exactly.
I want to get a boat one day.
But also to regenerate the earth, so to speak.
Yeah.
Get people more connected with what's happening.
Yeah, really, the poison thing is really out of control.
Ladies and gentlemen, we still have the speaker, and I'm asking a really important question.
the poison thing that's going on is really bad. You got to ask your parents, say, tell them you don't want more poisons at your house. Even things that are in your sink, like bleach and all these chemicals that are kept underneath the sinks, get them in the garage. They don't have to be in the house.
Guilty.
Well, I mean, it's, I was too. These things have to be learned, you know? And
yes.
Then when someone wants to get rid of weeds, you don't just spray a poison on it. That's lazy. You get down and pull it with your hands. That way you're getting it into the earth.
How did you become interested in this?
I started this because when I was about your age, my grandmother had a garden, and she sent me out there to look for tomatoes and cucumbers. And so it's one of the most fun things I remember as a kid is hunting for cucumbers, thinking you have every one of them, and then seeing that giant one that you forgot that was hiding. And when I saw that hiding cucumber, that's what got me hooked on gardening, because I wanted to have that discovery again.
Where was your grandmother?
My grandmother's name's Mary Lee Settle. She was she founded the Penn Faulkner Award for fiction. And she's a writer, and she had a home in Norfolk, Virginia. Yeah, mm-hmm. I was born in D.C., grew up in Costa Rica, but I've lived all over the place. So, Espanol es mi lengua primo, también. So I speak Spanish, but I'm a white guy. I always say, in Spanish you'd say, un gringo con un corazón tico. So I'm a white guy with a Costa Rican heart.
Yeah.
So,
what did your grandmother write?
Cool.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
What did your grandmother write?
Her name was Mary Lee Settle.
Yeah.
She wrote about 25 books. She won the National Book
no
Award
talking.
For Blood Tie. Or the Beulah Lang Quintet, I think.
Okay.
But you can look her up. She's the founder of the Penn Faulkner Award.
She founded the Penn
yeah.
Faulkner Award.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Oh my God.
Yep, yep. Because she won the National Book Award, and she was one of these very cantankerous. She didn't think she deserved it. She thought her buddy deserved it. And it was a popularity contest, she said. That's why she got it, because she was popular at the time. So she said she took it, saying the other guy should have got it. And then she found she took 15 grand, she saved up, and founded the Penn Faulkner Award. Yeah, and she's, so I've got all her writings and all her stuff at home, and you know, whatever we could save over the years. But you guys, I got to get to the next class.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It was really nice talking to you.
Are you filming?
Yes.
Oh, okay, no
yeah.
worries.
No, it's okay, I can turn it off.
No, you're fine.
Okay, I'm going
to
turn it off.
Because wanted to share something with
yes.
you.
Yes.
Carrie,
oh wow, where'd you get that?
I'm a level T book.
Awesome. Level T? Good for you.
You rock.
That's really awesome.
Yeah.
And look, see, this is all the important stuff you need to know about. See, staying safe with insects, because not all insects are, you know, they can sting you. Look at all those ladybugs. Look at them all. And you can get ladybugs and release them. And you want some more?
And she went and got that insect book
oh,
as
good.
You were talking, because she referred to it.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. So you love the insects.
Well,
you can study insects, you know.
She's always connecting to everything. So
great.
Really cool. You are one of the coolest individuals
oh, thank you.
I've met on
thank
the planet.
You. I appreciate it. Thank
oh,
you.
Oh, yeah. Do you have a business card?
One thing I forgot, but Urban Microfarms
you got it,
has
it.
My phone number there.
You got it. And because I have a plot of land, a little...
Okay.
I want to
sure.
turn into
yeah,
this.
Yeah, I do
that.
Consultations, you know.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, this is right up my alley.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Good.
I'm going to turn this off. And I got to find my next class, which I'm not